Right. Namaskar and a very warm welcome to everyone joined in today on our 25th Know Your Species, Know Your Zoo talk. This talk is being organized by the Central Zoo Authority in New Delhi as part of the ongoing Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. The Mahotsav is a 75-week-long celebration to commemorate 75 years of India's independence, which falls on the 15th of August 2022. The Central Zoo Authority is taking this celebration forward through a massive outreach campaign entitled Conservation to Coexistence, The People Connect. Under the helm of this campaign, we will be showcasing 75 conservation priority species and 75 zoos, highlighting one species and one zoo each week. We are currently in week 25 of the celebration with the pythons as the species in focus and the Rajkot Zoological Park as the zoo in focus. So joined in today to speak to us on the species is Dr. Ramesh Chinnaswamy. Dr. Ramesh is a faculty member of Wildlife Institute of India. He's a zoologist by training and has done his doctorate on the ecology of the Indian rock python in Pirlarbio National Park, Rajasthan. He has over a decade of experience in conservation science with interests in human-wildlife interactions, invasive species management, climate change, and coastal and marine research. Dr. Ramesh is also a member of the IUCN SSE Boa and Python Specialist Group. His talk today will be on the various aspects of ecology and biology of the three python species that are being highlighted this week. However, due to unforeseen circumstances, Dr. Ramesh is unable to join us in the live session, but has been kind enough to record the talk on the species in focus and share it with us, which we will present now. If there are any questions, please do leave it in the comments. We will try to answer them. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. This is Ramesh Chinnaswamy, faculty member from Wildlife Institute of India, Dehradun. I'm happy to be a part of this massive conservation awareness activities as part of Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav, commemoration of 75th years of India's independence under the theme Conservation to Coexistence, The People Connect, 75 weeks, 75 species, and 75 zoos. In this session, today we are going to discuss about the secret life history of pythons in India. Pythons comes under the order Squamata, suborder Serpentes. Pythons are very primitive snakes. They had evolved during the Cretaceous period, which was about 144 million years ago. In this picture, we can see the spores. Spores is the rudimentary characteristics of the legs, which is connecting link between the lizard-like animals and the snakes. The spores are larger in size with male pythons and relatively smaller in size female pythons. During the mating process, these spores used as grip, and these spores are loosely attached with the pelvic girdle of the snakes. Generally, snakes doesn't have the legs. If there is no legs, no problem at all, and they still move in a variety of ways. In general, the snakes are following four different methods for the movement. These movements are varies from species to species. Pythons follow the rectilinear method in general, and when they are in danger or threatened, they use concertina method to move from one place to another place. Pythons are very lethargic snakes, and following the rectilinear method, they can retain a lot of energy and move far away from their original locations. Pythons are restless like Russell Viper and common sand boa. If a person who is handling the snake could not identify the difference between the Russell Viper and python, that will be in danger. So, any snake catcher, first of all, they have to make sure what species they are handling. India supports high diversity of snakes. More than 305 snake species are recorded in India, of which majority of them are non-venomous snakes. Our ancestors were very well aware about the importance of the snakes, which plays a crucial role in the agroforest ecosystem. These snakes are having a secret life history in nature, so sampling is very difficult, and studying these snakes are always challenging. Whatever the literatures are available that is pertaining to the status, distribution and taxonomy of the snakes. Ecology of free-ranging snakes in India is poorly known. Available information is restricted with mainly Euro-pelted snakes, pit vipers and king cobra. And recently we have studied about Indian rock python ecology in Kalathea National Park and Satyamangalam and Mudumalai Tiger Reserve. Those information we are going to discuss here. In India, we are having three species of python and three species of boas. The main difference between the python and boas are, like, pythons are egg layers, so it is called oviparous snakes, and boas are producing the live animals, hence it is called ovoviviparous. Under the Boinae, in India we are having three species of boas: common sand boa, red sand boa and vitiges boa. Boas in India are smaller in size when it is compared with the boas from Africa and other New World countries. Pythons are considered the family Pythoninae. Around the world, more than 40 species of pythons are there in the family. In India, we are having three species of pythons. They are Burmese rock python, Indian rock python and Malayo python. They can be easily discriminated based on their coloration and blotch pattern method. And Burmese pythons are relatively pale in yellow color when it is compared with the Indian rock python, which is darker in color. And Malayo python has the net-like structure on their blotch pattern, that means at the dorsal natural marking. Hence, it is called reticulated python. The Burmese python scientific name is Python bivitatus bivitatus. For Indian python, it is Python molurus molurus. For Malayo python, it is Python reticulatus reticulatus. Until 2009, Burmese rock python considered as a subspecies of Indian rock python. After that, the Burmese python was elevated as a separate species. However, Burmese and Indian rock pythons, still they are able to mate and hybridize, produce the viable offspring. The main difference between these two species is like pink coloration on their dorsal part of the head, which is present in Indian rock python. And for Burmese rock python, this pink coloration generally not there. And main differentiation we could see through the scale around the eyes of the both the species. About 9 ocular scales are present around the eyes of the both the species. The only difference is the supralabial scale directly touches with the eye of Indian rock python, which is not present in Burmese rock python. That means the supralabial scale is not directly touches with the eye, which was separated by the subocular scale in Burmese rock python. In this slide, we can see all three species of python distribution in India as well as in Southeast Asia. The red color denotes that Indian python distribution, and yellow color indicate the distribution of Burmese python, and green color indicating the distribution of the reticulated pythons. The Indian pythons are not present in northeastern part of the country, and the Burmese pythons, other than northeastern part, it is located in several pocketed area in northern part and eastern part of India. The purple color in Sri Lanka indicating the presence of Python molurus bimburi, and in the reticulated python is distributed in five islands. Our Burmese python established as an invasive species in the United States of America during 1990s. The pythons kept as a pet in United States people. After that, 1 or 2 years later, usually the pythons grows up to 7 or 8 feet, and then the rapid growth usually there. People cannot hold the larger size snakes, so they tend to release the neighbor forest areas. So this type of pythons established as an invasive species and threatening the native fauna in US. The United States government has spent millions of dollars to eradicate this species, but till date they could not success. All these three snakes are the largest snakes in the world, and they occupy a variety of habitats. These snakes comes under the Schedule 1 of Indian Wildlife Protection Act 1972. To reduce the trade of these snakes' body parts, these species are included in Convention International Trade in Endangered Species. The studies on these three species are poorly known, and ecology of this endangered species are being studied mainly in Indian rock python. All these three snakes are very good swimmer, and they can submerge under the water up to 30 minutes. Sometimes they hunt down the animals under the water also. They are very good climber. Like all other reptiles, pythons also pycnotherms. That means they are cold-blooded animals. Their activity mainly driven by the environmental temperature, and all of them are giant constrictors. The related species is African rock python, and their sexual maturity, when they are reaching about 7 feet size, they become matured animals. In general, the reptile sexual maturity is depending upon the size of the animal rather than the age. Sexual size dimorphism exists in pythons, which means the females are larger in size when it is compared with the male. In Nicobar Islands, we have a decent population of reticulated python. In northeastern part of our country, only the sporadic record of reticulated pythons are there. In this picture, we can see the typical habitat of reticulated pythons. In Nicobar Islands, sometimes this reticulated python goes to human habitation and hunt down the domesticated animals. That becomes a conflict, and the tribal people try to hunt down these animals. Sometimes they consume their meat. Out of these three species, we have extensive studies and information available only in Indian rock python. Indian python and Burmese rock python biologically more or less similar, so this information can be compared with the Burmese rock python. During 2007 to 2010, we have done an ecological study on Indian rock python in Kaldev National Park, Bharatpur, Rajasthan. And recently we have conducted another study from 2017 to 2021 on spatio-temporal and thermal ecology of Indian rock python in Satyamangalam and Mudumalai Tiger Reserves in Tamil Nadu. In Bharatpur, pythons are mainly preferred to stay in porcupine burrows because there is no other microhabitat available to escape from the extreme weather and climatic condition in Rajasthan. In Kaldev National Park, there are about 50 burrows are there. We have done extensive fortnight survey on these burrows to understand their distribution and the population status of Indian pythons. Porcupine burrows act as a refuge of pythons and many other animals because these burrows are maintaining a constant temperature throughout the year when it is compared with the ambient temperature. In Rajasthan, extreme climatic conditions are there during winter. Sometimes the temperatures goes below 0 degrees Celsius. During the summer, the temperature goes up beyond the 45 degrees Celsius. Being a cold-blooded animals, these porcupine burrows providing the optimum refugia for these snakes survival. We have recorded about 16 other species as cohabiting animals of python in Kaladev National Park. And some of the notable species are monitor lizard, Microchiropteran bats, Indian porcupine, golden jackal, and striped hyena. These porcupine burrows providing more favorable condition for almost all the animals. This is also helping for these animals to rear their young one. Interestingly, the porcupine also is part of the diet of pythons. Hyena, jackal, and pythons act as a predator as well as prey. Some of the burrows are being used by various animals simultaneously, and population estimation of python is available only from Kaladev National Park study, which was conducted between 2007 and 2010. Other than that, no other such studies on population estimation of python available around the world. We have followed three different methods to assess the population status of python in this national park. The first method is sum of maximum number of pythons present in the different burrows. We have conducted the fortnight survey to arrive the number for this particular method. And the second method is individual identification of each snakes during our study. About 124 pythons we could identify based on their dorsal natural blotch pattern method. Dorsal blotch pattern method is easy and very effective method, which means the dorsal part of the snakes having the different shape of the blotches. If you are able to identify first two blotches, it could give 80% difference between the individuals. And if you are considering more than four blotches on the dorsal side, and if you are keep recording of these things, which will help us to differentiate between one individual to another individual. It is like a human fingerprinting, and it won't go away when it is grows. So this method easily can be followed in captive conditions, and also it can be used in the wild for long-term monitoring purposes. Last method is mark recapture method. This method is mainly used for a variety of other animals, and the first time we have used it in pythons in Kaladev National Park based on the natural blotch pattern method sighting and resighting. Based on this method, we could arrive the number of snakes is between 116 and 183 present in this park. Based on the sighting and resighting of different pythons, we could generate information of movement and ranging pattern in Kaladev National Park. Generally, the medium-sized snakes, that is 8 to 12 feet snakes, moves a longer distance when it is compared with the juveniles and the older ones. And snakes usually move from 500 meter to 2 kilometer distance in this park. To understand the food and feeding habit of animals is central aspects of ecology of any of the animals, particularly in pythons. So having the extreme physiological adaptation to digest the larger prey species in a very short period of time. Also, pythons are having a unique organ called pit organ, which is activated by protein channels, is usually helps them to identify the prey species and also to differentiate the temperature level. Even 0.2 degrees Celsius different also the python can understand using the pit organs. These pit organs are available in boas, pythons and viper species, which will help them to understand the structure of the prey species. According to the prey size, the python can decide whether they can hunt down the animals or not. When pythons are in juvenile stage, they are voracious eater. They mainly prefer to eat smaller animals like frogs, toads, rats, mice, and many other smaller lizards. When it is reaches up to 7 feet, it become matured and their food habits shift from smaller animals to the larger animals like deer, wild boar, and many other warm-blooded animals. Other than direct observation, for studying the food and feeding habit, 3 standard methods are available. The first one is gut content analysis, second one is stomach flushing, and third one is fecal analysis. The first 2 methods are invasive methods, so it is discouraged to do with the endangered species. Hence, we have followed the third method, the fecal analysis method. We have collected the fecal sample of pythons and analyzed to know the prey species of pythons. In this slide, we can see the fecal matter as well as the uric acid, the typical characteristics of the reptile species. And we could try to locate the undigestive part like bones, feathers, and hair of the mammals. For segregating the hairs, we have used a trichotaxonomy method to identify the mammalian species, which helped us to know the prey species of pythons. Generally, adult pythons eat 2 or 3 times per year only. However, in captivity, we tend to provide a lot of food or overfeeding the snakes, which is negatively influenced their physiological conditions. In the field, they eat a larger prey species when it is reached the adult, and the frequency of taking the food also is restricted from minimum 1 to maximum 3. The python can fast up to 2 years. This record is available from the captivity. Our study from Kyaladev National Park, Bharatpur shows their main preferred diets are mammalian species, which was constituted about 79.6%, and bird species constituted about 16.7%. Only 3.7% the reptile diets were there. The main preferred species are spotted deer, which was constituted about 55%, and other species are like rhesus macaque, mongoose, jungle cat, rodent, sambar deer, striped hyena, wild boar, and Indian porcupines are other preferred species. And we have also observed ontogenic shift, that means the smaller python feed on smaller prey and larger ones feed on larger prey. Being an ectotherm, that means the cold-blooded animals, their activity is mainly influenced by the environmental temperature. According to the temperature, python maintain their body temperature through behavioral means. And their daily and seasonal activities of pythons is influenced by the atmospheric temperature and some extent through the relative humidity. In Rajasthan, unimodal activity of pythons observed during the winter and bimodal activity observed during in spring and summer. That means during winter, pythons observed only in daytime when it comes for sunbasking, And during spring and summer, the dial activity or crepuscular pattern of activity observed in Rajasthan. Based on our 3-year study in Bharatpur, the result illustrated that during winter we can see many number of pythons when they are doing the sunbasking, and during the summer we could see very few number of pythons. That is because of increased nocturnal activity. We have done extensive focal animal sampling that have conducted between morning 6 o'clock to evening 6 o'clock during December to April. That means winter through summer gradient, we have studied the focal animal sampling to know the emergence and retreat of the snake with relation to the environmental parameters. And during this time, each and every individual of the snake identified based on the plunge pattern. In a single burrow, we could estimate 29 pythons are presented in the same time. Based on our focus sampling result, we come to know that the python mainly active between morning 10 o'clock to afternoon 2 o'clock. And this time duration also varies according to the season. During the winter, the peak activity period observed in the midday, that is around 12 to 2 o'clock. And during the summer, the peak activity period is observed between 10 to 2. And during the summer, the activity is restricted during the night time, and some of the activity is observed in morning 6 o'clock and morning 10 o'clock. This graph illustrated 29 pythons which was presented in the same burrow and studied through focal sampling method. We could see that none of the pythons are active throughout the study. Sometimes pythons were active only for some time, and remaining time they were there inside the burrow. They have not come out of the burrow. This is also a kind of behavioral thermoregulation or adaptation, because when the outside temperature are very low or when it goes beyond the normal level, pythons are preferred to stay inside the burrow. That burrow temperature is relatively optimum to maintain their physiological condition of the snake. Another important aspect is skin shedding or molting of the snake. Snakes need to shed their skin regularly while they grow. If they shed only single piece of skin, which is indicating the good health condition of the snakes. If skin shedding is happening bits and pieces, which means the snakes are sick, it's required attention in captive condition. Breeding is the most powerful motivation common to all organisms. In python, we have recorded the two mode of reproduction. The first one is sexual reproduction, another one is asexual reproduction, which is also called parthenogenesis. That means the male presence is not required. Without the sperm, the female itself can fertilize on its own and produce viable female offspring. And aggregation have usually recorded in the hibernation dens in northern India. And these hibernation dens are not there in the southern India because of the prevailing different type of climatic conditions. Interestingly, majority of the reptiles do not show the parental care. However, pythons have parental care, which is mainly directed towards the eggs. Very little information available on the reproductive biology of these free-ranging pythons. We have completed one detailed study on breeding biology of Indian pythons, which is available. Being a poikilotherm animals, they mainly follow the behavioral thermoregulation. However, during the breeding time, they behave like a homeotherms or warm-blooded animal-like pattern. During the breeding, they use several thermogenesis to maintain their nest temperature that will help to grow the embryos. Pythons are generally a solitary animals. They can seen in a group or in aggregation during the mating time. The mating process usually starts in February in northern India, and in southern India, the mating process starts in January. The mating duration of pythons varies from 1 hour to 4 hours. Pythons having two pair of hemipenes. Generally, we could see the right side hemipenes used for the mating process. And after the mating, maybe after 1 month, python tend to lay the eggs and incubate it about 60 days to 75 days for the hatching. Our breeding biology study from the field indicate that pythons were able to maintain constant temperature between 31 degrees Celsius and 34 degrees Celsius throughout the incubation period, irrespective of the fluctuation of atmospheric temperature, which was helping them to maintain the average growth of embryos in the eggs. In this slide, I would like to draw your attention that the pythons did not feed during the incubation. At the end of the incubation, that is after 2 months, they were abandoned the nest. That is due to the increased oxygen demand by the neonate to facilitate that the female pythons abandon the nest, and also the ectoparasite proliferation also recorded. To escape from this parasite proliferation, pythons went off from the nest, and python followed a severing thermogenesis to maintain the body temperature, and the nesting pythons behaved like a homeotherms. In captivity, the similar phenomenon have been observed. When they abandon the nest, the captive breeder usually shift the egg to the artificial incubation, which lead to the highest amount of mortality of the juvenile pythons. If you want to have the higher percentage of success rate of hatchlings, the eggs should not be transferred to the artificial incubation. About 2 months of incubation by the mother is enough for the embryo growth. After that, it can be left alone for the atmospheric temperature till hatching. In summary, python mating is observed between December and April, and egg laying usually happening in May. And based on our study, we have recorded about 19 to 37 eggs. The earlier record was minimum is 6 and maximum is 108. The size of the snakes and the age of the snakes determine the number of clutch size. The incubation period is usually about 74 days, which includes 61 days of active incubation by the mother, and about 2 weeks was unattended by the female pythons. The nest temperature is between 31 degrees Celsius and 33 degrees Celsius, and hatching success was 95% recorded in the wild. The hatchling length average size is 60 centimeter, which is about only 2 feet, and the hatching weight is around 110 grams. We have done extensive radio telemetry research in southern India along the Moyar River Valley using the transmitters. We have kept the transmitter just above the tail region of pythons. In this picture, we have illustrated the area where we kept the transmitter and eye buttons to study the spatial and temporal thermal ecology of pythons. After transmitter implantation procedure, we have continuously monitored the snake for 24 hours to ensure a good health condition of the pythons, and after that released in the wild for continuous tracking of pythons. Our study results indicate that python having a strong homing instinct of both male and females. Their average home range varies from 500 square meter to 4 square kilometer. And also we want to know whether they are able to return to their home or not. If they are able to return to home, what could be the maximum distance they can find its home? To address these questions, we have released a python from its home range to 1 kilometer, 2 kilometer, 3 kilometer, up to 15 kilometer, and also we have released 25 kilometer and 50 kilometer to know their homing instinct. Up to 11 kilometer, the python's able to find out its home area and return. It took about 10 to 11 months to return their home area, and beyond 11 kilometer, pythons have not tried to return and settled in the released site itself. During our study, we could see python using several type of micro habitat to maintain their body temperature. Some of the examples given in the slide: the rock crevices, burrows, inside tree hollows, under the tree, on the branches, and inside leaf litter, dry bushes were the some of the preferred area where the python can stay and maintain their body temperature and avoid their predator. About 88% are terrestrial area habitat utilization observed, and 6% each aquatic and arboreal utilization by pythons were recorded. Our thermal biology study results indicate that throughout the year, python able to maintain very narrow range of temperature, that is between 28 to 31 degrees Celsius. This temperature may be followed under the captive conditions. In summary, medium-sized snakes, that is between 8 and 12 feet, move extensively, and the juvenile pythons do not show much movement. And the female of this species are quite larger and heavy, so sexual dimorphisms observed in all the three species. During the mating period, several males observed with a single female. However, we have not observed any male-male combat process. The mating season of Indian python starts early in January due to optimal warmer temperature, and their reproduction is highly seasonal. Based on the radio telemetry, first time we have generated the ray location data of pythons, and we found that the homing instinct present in Indian pythons, both male and female, up to 11 kilometer they are able to find their home, and feeding frequency observed in adult pythons between 1 and 3. The sexual dimorphisms are there, females are larger in size. Also, most importantly, we have recorded the smallest matured male python, which was about 198 centimeter. Earlier record was about 210 centimeter was the smallest male matured python record. So now we come to know that if python is reaches 198 centimeter, they are able to mate and produce the offspring. Generally, pythons are solitary species. Aggregation recorded only during mating season in southern India. Aggregation is recorded in northern India during the winter to maintain the body temperature, and also aggregation recorded during the mating process. They are polygamous species, and male biased sex ratio observed in both northern India and southern Indian landscape. Our study results also indicate the prevailing the negative perception and fear among the people will directly influence the survival of the snakes. The people who are in fear, they tend to kill the pythons, so that the creating awareness and providing knowledge to the locals is very important to conserve this endangered species. many other anthropogenic activity like the linear infrastructure development, road, railways are the major cause of python mortality. Sometimes in the aquatic area, the fishing nets also a major problem for smaller pythons, and some of the bigger pythons also entangled with the net in Gujarat and some other part of northern India. Generally, all pythons are calm and harmless to the human beings. Being an apex predator, their ecological role and maintaining the ecological balance is very important in any given landscape. In Nicobar Islands, reticulated python is the only apex predator which is maintaining the ecological balance in the island ecosystem. If you want any further information and clarification, you are welcome to contact through my email ID provided in this slide. Thank you one and all.
Right, so with that, we come to the end of the species section. Big thank you to Dr. Ramesh. If any of you have any questions for this section, please do write it in the comments. We will take it up at the end of the session. We now move on to the part on the zoo, which is in the Rajkot Zoological Park. So joined in with us is Dr. R.K. Hirpara, who is the zoo superintendent and of the zoo. A brief introduction of Dr. Hirpara. He's a veterinarian by training and has over two decades of experience in animal welfare and management. His work has been in both in-situ and ex-situ facilities within Gujarat. And apart from managing and coordinating for the betterment of zoo, Dr. Hirpara is also helming the role of the secretary of the Rajkot Biodiversity Management Committee, which is to make the city more sustainable in terms of the urban biodiversity management. So over to you, sir, for your talk on the zoo.
Thank you. Namaskar and good afternoon to all of you. Let's start the presentation of the Rajkot Zoological Park, Rajkot. In Rajkot Zoological Park, the governing body is, I will tell you, the most of the zoo in India, most of the zoo in India is managed by the State Forest Department. But in Rajkot Zoo, the zoo is managed by the municipal corporation, that is the Rajkot Municipal Corporation. All management and financial supports are provided from the municipal corporation authorities. Right now, Mr. Amit Arora is the municipal commissioner at present in our Rajkot. This is the mission of the Rajkot Zoological Park: inspiring love and empathy for wildlife amongst public and awareness for nature conservation. This is the mission of our Rajkot Zoo. Each and every zoo, there is some objective to complement and strengthen the national efforts in conservation of the rich biodiversity of the country, particularly the local wildlife. First objective is conservation. To support the conservation of the endangered species through coordinated breeding program under ex-situ. Second is the education. To inspire amongst zoo visitors empathy for wild animals and understanding and awareness about the need for the conservation of the natural resources and other maintaining the ecological balance. Third is the research. To provide opportunity for scientific study useful for conservation in general and create of data base for sharing between the agencies involved in in-situ and ex-situ conservation. Besides the aforesaid objectives, the zoo will function as a rescue center for orphaned wild animals subject to the availability of the appropriate housing and upkeep infrastructure. Then I will brief about our Rajkot Zoo. Earlier, the Rajkot Zoo was known as a Azidev, which was established in 1987. As per the guideline from Central Zoo Authority, New Delhi, zoo was shifted from old site to new site, which is named as Pradyuman Park, and the name of the zoo is Rajkot Zoological Park, and it is started in 2009. Rajkot Zoological Park covered about 137 acres area, which is undulating with ridges and valleys, rocky outskirts, and well-drained, surrounded by two big lakes. That is, one side is Lalpari Lake, and on other side there is a Randhrada Lake. This area was considered as an ideal site for developing a modern zoological park to be known as Rajkot Zoological Park, which was inaugurated by our Honorable Chief Minister of the Gujarat State during that time, Sri Narendra Modi, on 14th August 2010. He was very keen about the zoo and its importance for conservation and education. This is the satellite map of the Rajkot Zoological Park. You can see the map of the zoo, and both one side is Lalpari Lake and other side is Randhrada Lake. This is the staffing pattern of our Rajkot Zoo. Zoo has a full zoo superintendent. One post is full zoo superintendent. One is full has a veterinary officer, curator, biologist, senior clerk, junior clerk, veterinary assistant, peon, head animal keepers, keepers, and all are permanent staff. And second is the contractual staff. In contrast to staff, we include sweepers, ticket booking operators, drivers for battery cars, tube well operator, security guards, workers for miscellaneous work, etc. This is the fees for visitors and timing. The fees for adult is 25 rupees per head, and fees for children between 3 years to 12 years is 10 rupees. And this is the booking time. Booking time is 9 to 6:30. And in every zoo, one day remain closed. In Rajkot Zoological Park, zoo remain closed every Friday for visitors and other. This is the annual visitors from 2015 to 16. You can see the year by year the number of the visitors is increasing, but in 2010 and 2020 to 2021 there is a COVID situation, so the zoo remain closed for all kind of visitors, so the number of the visitors is declining. This is the silent features. Now in Rajkot Zoo, the present animal collection include mammals. In mammals, 23rd species of the different mammals, and the number of animals is 178 numbers. Regarding birds, about 24 species of the birds are housed, and the number of the birds is 235 numbers. And reptiles, reptiles 7 species is housed, and the number of the reptiles is 29 species. Now the total species in Rajkot Zoo is 55 species, and the total number of the animals is 442. This is the important slide. Now I am telling about the Asiatic Lion Conservation Breeding Program. Rajkot Zoological Park is the participating zoo for the Plant Coordinated Conservation Breeding Program for Asiatic Lions, and the zoo has succeeded in breeding this species at Rajkot Zoo. Till date, 49 Asiatic Lions have been born in zoo. Thus, there is a good pool for knowledge and experience for breeding of the Asiatic Lion, which will be continued as a part of the zoo development of the species conservation. For this facility, existing old mini zoo called as Azidam Zoo is converted as a breeding center for Asiatic Lion, and this zoo is off display for visitors. This is the features expansion. In the year 2019-20, Central Zoo Authority has approved the master plan of the Rajkot Zoological Park. In view of that, Rajkot Zoological Park is going to execute remaining project in approved master plan. This include the rhino exhibit of the rhino, Indian wild dog, baboon, flamingo city, kangaroo, wallaby, marshland for birds, jaguar, butterfly, nocturnal house, cactus park, turtles exhibit, etc. Each and every zoo, this is the importance for each and every zoo for veterinary care. Rajkot Zoological Park has best in class veterinary hospital with all the basic and advanced equipment, accessories, infrastructures to maintain and management for proper health and hygiene of the animals. This veterinary hospital is well maintained with operation theater, surgical room, X-ray room, medicine room, laboratory for testing samples, tranquilizing equipment, drugs, post-operative recovery room, speech cage, etc. This our veterinary hospital also has an indoor patient ward isolation for type disease. Education and awareness program during the year, Rajkot Zoo conduct regularly the education and awareness programs. Zoo organized one day nature education camp for students of the various schools and colleges throughout the year. It's sad to be awareness about wildlife and to understand the zoo management among the students. Interiors play a major role in. They also learn many things. Checking in a zoo with detailed explanations and interest. The curriculum include lectures, wildlife film show, expert talk, keeper talk, bird watching, and learning tips, quiz, etc. This is what class of the education camp earlier did. Our zoo is also created an interpretation center. Rajkot Zoological Park has created state-of-the-art interpretation center for visitors and students. This interpretation center promotes necessary and information about the zoo, wildlife and their habitats, and more than 150 animals and birds. There are six wildlife galleries in zoo galleries. Gir ecosystem, reptiles gallery, birds gallery, mammals gallery, Kutch ecosystem gallery, etc. There have been a light and sound show, sound panels, interactive panels, and many other informative activities provided in this interpretation center. Our zoo has a lot of amenities for visitors, including computer ticket booking office, vehicle parking, large vehicle parking, toilet blocks and bathroom, resting shed, drinking water points, canteens, children corner, zoo exhibited guide maps, food court, battery operated vehicles, open gypsy, clock room, lawn and garden, CCTV camera, and wheelchair for wheelchair and baby prams. This is the photographs for amenities for visitors. This is the photographs of zoo development site before development. You can see there is no any development, there is no any plantation. Now I will show you the exhibit and landscape at present. This is the tiger exhibit. This is the open top leopard exhibit with enrichment. Coming here. This is the exhibit for Himalayan black bear. This is the lake view point. Earlier I say you there is a both side of lake. One side is developed for visitors to show the lake. This is the city view point. Here we can see the city of the building of the cities. This is the heritage of the inside zoo. This is some key points to consider for present and future expect to create more natural ambience for visitors using eco-friendly and sustainable techniques, upgradation of visitor facilities, capacity building of the staff to cope up with latest technology around the globe, improves in education module for visitors, students and outreach activities, improvement in enrichment facility for all animals, to find more income generation ideas as per local scenario, learn and implement more comprehensive techniques for zoo management. Now I'm ending my presentation and I will show you some small about you.
Animals, and they also learn about the importance of wildlife conservation. One such beautiful zoological park has already taken a shape at Rajkot. The aim is to establish a zoo according to the standard guideline of CZA at Pradyuman Park of Rajkot. The zoo was inaugurated by present Honorable Prime Minister of India and former Chief Minister of Gujarat, Shri Narendra Modi, in August 2010. The zoo is located between Lalpali and Ratalda lakes, spread across 137 acres. Where huge cages have been installed in the lap of nature, the zoo gives a special experience to each and every visitor. Here, the visitors get mesmerized by the sight of Asiatic lion, tiger, white tiger, panther, bear, deer, monkey, hyena, wolf, jackal, and fox. Apart from that, a well-equipped reptile house has 14 different species of snakes, as well as marsh crocodiles. The visitors can feel the sound of nature by chirping of the birds. A bird visitory, parrot aviary, walk-through aviary, peacock cages have been installed, as well as a huge open duck pond has also been created. More than 70 species of birds give a unique experience to bird watchers. The area covered by more than 40,000 trees is like a natural jungle. Here visitors feel themselves close to the nature. In order to enhance people's participation in the efforts of saving precious nature and wildlife, as well as the betterment of animals and zoo, Friends of Zoo scheme has been introduced. In this scheme, people can adopt an animal from the zoo. At the zoo, visitors get all the facilities like pollution-free, eco-friendly battery car and bicycle, as well as toilet, resting shed, drinking water points, children's play area, garden, snacks, and a nearby restaurant. A fully equipped hospital building has been established in the zoo, where veterinary officers take care of all the birds and animals of the zoo. Central Zoo Authority, New Delhi, has selected Rajkot Zoo as a participating zoo for protection and conservation of Asiatic lions. 51 lion cubs have born in the zoo till 2017. The zoo protects genetically pure Asiatic lions. The zoological park encourages students to learn and research about behavior, daily activities, and lifestyle of animals, which is going to be helpful in protection of wild animals. The zoo also organizes environmental education camps for students of various schools and colleges, teachers training camp, and celebrates various environmental days and wildlife week. Zoo Interpretation Center is the main attraction for visitors. In this interpretation center, visitors get the interesting information and knowledge about wildlife through different galleries. The Zoological Park provides an opportunity to understand various aspects of wildlife and to participate in protection and conservation of the same. To visitors, students, and nature lovers.
Thank you very much.
Right. Thank you so much, sir, for the introduction to the zoo and for the virtual tour. We now move on to the question and answer session for both the sections. So we have a few questions on the python, on the species as well. So we have Dr. Gauri Mallapur with us, who is the veterinary consultant at CZA, and she would be answering the questions on Dr. Ramesh's behalf. So we have the first question is that are there any reports of hybridization between the species of python, and which species is most threatened and why?
In India, among the three species that we have in the wild, there have been no reports of any hybridization in nature. Though there have been reports of hybridization, not in India, probably in Florida with the Burmese python, they have found genes of Indian rock python in there. So to answer your question, in India, there is no report for hybridization of the three species. All three species have the same level of protection. They're protected under Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act. And I think it's a well-deserved protection for the species.
All right. The second question is that what enrichments would you suggest for python exhibits in zoos?
In the presentation that Dr. Ramesh did, he spoke about pythons having heat sensing pits. Also, utilization of that, their ability to climb, their ability to swim. So using these aspects of the biology of the python, enrichment can be provided. So not only just physical infrastructure that can be given to them, but also using scent, smells, different kinds of smells, they will react to that. So those can be used quite effectively in enclosures. And it's a good thing to get them to move their large-bodied snakes. And it's good if they get exercise in the space that is provided to them. So spatial utilization is better.
Okay, and the final question that we have is that how many sets of teeth do pythons have?
Indian rock python has, all three species actually, have more than 100 teeth, and they are organized in two rows on the upper and lower jaw. So I would not have an answer to the exact number, and I don't think anybody's actually done a physical count yet. I don't have the answer to that question. But they have more than 100 teeth and in two rows, and they are curved backwards, so it's not a pleasant bite.
All right, so those were the questions on the species section. We now move on to the questions for the zoo. So, sir, the first question for you is, what are the future plans for modernization of the zoo?
Let me give the answer for this. Good evening, everyone. I'm Ravi Chauhan. I'm a biologist at Rajkot Zoological Park. As sir told that the master plan is already approved of Rajkot Zoological Park, and we are in a stage of completion of that master plan according to the creating infrastructure and other facilities at the zoo. Most of the exhibits are on the edge of completion. Few, as we have seen in the presentation, are remaining part of the zoo to be constructed in future. Apart from that, I would like to tell this to the people that CZA has also selected Rajkot Zoo among the top 15 zoos of the country as a plan of vision plan of India in the zoos. So zoo is also planning to put itself on an international platform also, and trying to create the best possible infrastructure and management guidelines which can match the at par with any other zoos in the world. So we are trying to do that also, and soon as we are also planning other what we can say, this we are planning our website also. So soon we will going to put our website on the platform, so more people can reach us easily. And there are so many other things going on in the zoo, so gradually we are developing our zoo in a systematic manner.
All right, sir. The next question is that, as a zoo practitioner, what do you think are the challenges in reptile management in the zoos, and are there any constraints that you face, and what should be done to make them more visitor engaging?
What I will say that reptiles are one of the most species of attraction in the zoos, because visitors coming to the zoos are not often seeing the reptiles like snakes, crocodiles, pythons, free-ranging or near in, even in the wild, even they cannot see it easily. So in zoo, they can easily see the animals and they can observe the animals. So among what we have observed, that pythons and other snakes are key species displaying in the zoos, which are attractive to those visitors. What difficulty basically most of the zoos are facing, we need to give them food in a proper way, then only and we need to see the all this reptile species, especially in the snakes, they only feed live feeds. So we have to create that feed portion of those species separately and breed them inside the zoo to get this problem. And at present we are not facing such problem, so this is a general, in general I am telling that this can be the problem in the zoos.
All right, sir, those were the questions for you, and with that we come to an end to this to the 25th Know Your Species, Know Your Zoo talk. On behalf of CZA, I would like to thank both Dr. Heerpara and to you, Mr. Ravi, for being part of this series, and to Dr. Ramesh for sending in his talk on the species, and to Dr. Gauri for answering the questions on the python section. I would also thank our viewers for engaging with us and being part of the entire talk. And I would like to tell them that Rajkot Zoological Park will be continuing with their outreach activities till Sunday. So do follow the social media pages to know more on what activity they have planned for the remaining days. And we will meet again on next week on Wednesday from 4 to 5 p.m. with the Indian Star Tortoise as the species in focus and the Kamala Nehru Zoo Ahmedabad as the zoo in focus. So thank you once again, and
thank you.
Do take care. Okay.